There is some absolutely amazing animation on the web. Shorts and web shows that just have the cleanest and smoothest looking animation, while still maintaining a unique art style of its own. It's something that can really inspire you, yet intimidate you at the same time. Like, damn, how did they get this good with their craft? There's also some web shows that, while they might not have the most mind-blowing animation, they still find a way not only to stand out, but pick an art style that matches the tone they're going for. This is just as, if not more, important. And then sometimes you just draw a stick figure and call today. Yeah, I can't really draw. I wish I could. I practice. But I kinda suck. But anyone can draw a stick figure, yeah? Probably won't go too far with just a simple stick figure, but at least it's something you're guaranteed to be able to do. If it's your only means of telling a story or making a joke, it's a nice tool. Granted, with that being said, I guess it just makes it all the more special when you are able to make something with stick figures that actually does become something popular. Man, I loved this show growing up. It had everything that a 14-year-old in 2010 wanted out of a web show. Shouting, cursing, farts, dubstep, auto-tune voices for no reason, sex jokes, memes, ninjas, thinking that words like burrito and bacon were funny on their own with no actual punchline being set up. Several things that I don't think I'm allowed to laugh at anymore in the year 2024. I sent out some forums, I'm waiting to hear back. It was truly something that belonged in the time it came from. I gotta say, out of the four web shows I've covered so far, it's probably the one that has aged the worst. Stupid Mario Brothers is still a very wholesome series, despite dropping in quality near the end of it. I can't think of a single terrible thing it did. Sonic for Hire was mean-spirited, but it still had a fun narrative at the start, and memorable versions of beloved characters. Pokemon Rusty was very short, stayed consistent in quality, and while it was edgy, it's not really the let's try to offend everyone type of edgy. And honestly, I don't think that's what Dick Figure's objective was either. Offensive jokes aren't even the main reason I think the show is outdated. I think the show is outdated because it echoed a lot of the humor of the early 2010s. I mean, just look at some of it.
Zombies! Oh, damn!
Stella, listen, I wanted to bring you here because I wanted to tell you that we can't be together.
How come? You're so old, and you're so wise, and you have so many abs.
No, my muscles are too big.
Oh, my face!
And not a single fuck was given that day.
Although just because something is outdated doesn't mean we can't still appreciate things about it. For starters, despite the simple animation style, I mean simple as in probably the most simple art style you could have, it does have very active animation. There's a lot going on in these. Anyone can draw a stick figure, but not everyone can animate them this smoothly, while consistently putting out episodes with a lot of moving pieces. A lot of these episodes have simple but unique backgrounds. They're not recycling a lot. We often have a lot of characters on the screen, each of which have to be drawn over and over again. And in the case of the Dick Figures movie, they really go all out with what you can accomplish with a stick figure animation. I mean, they have a freaking art book for this movie. Clearly a lot of effort and passion went into it. And boy, did I have my eyes on it when it got announced. I remember attending a live stream where they were storyboarding a scene for the movie, where someone in the chat told Red's voice actor and one of the series creators, Ed Scudder, to draw a llama on Blue's lunchbox, which he did. Someone else then asked for that llama to also be holding a lunchbox that also had a llama on it.
I swear to God, I'm more productive than this. There's a lot of going on YouTube, okay? Beautiful. Can we go one level deeper? Yes, we can.
And then that shit actually made it into the movie. That made my fucking day. I witnessed film history that day. The movie has some really solid background work, definitely a major step up from the show. They color in Red and Blue's faces to help them blend into these more detailed backgrounds, which was a very smart move. And just look at some of these chase scenes. Sure, this level of effort wasn't present in the web show, but I do think it's a good indicator that the love for the show did exist. It wasn't just a, hey, let's be hip with the kids project. I was so excited when the Dick Figures movie got announced. I remember I really wanted to donate to it so I could get a copy of it when it got released, but I was a kid without a credit card, so I talked my grandma into getting me a gift card so I could donate to it. Because she sure as hell wasn't about to put her credit card information into some website she never heard of. And then a day or two later, I got an email saying that the transaction was rejected by the card issuer. Now, I was a stupid fucking kid and didn't understand anything about money or how this worked, so I figured the card issuer was my grandma. She was notified of it somehow, and when she saw what I wanted to spend the money on, she canceled it. She knew I was donating to a Kickstarter after I described to her what a Kickstarter was, but she didn't know what it was for, because I sure as hell wasn't about to tell her that I wanted to donate to something called Dick Figures. When I got that email, I was terrified. She had no clue what that was. What if she thought I was trying to buy? Anyways, I didn't realize that the money was put back on the card because, again, I was a fucking dipshit kid. Maybe most kids would have figured that out regardless, I don't know. And I didn't get to donate to the Dick Figures movie or get my grandma's $25 back. It just lied on a card for... ever, I guess. Dick Figures the movie stole $25 from me. But, like, they didn't even use the money. They're just, like, the completionist! Okay, I bet someone laughed at that, but I probably pissed way more people off with that one. He donated the money, that's all I care about. No more punching down, I'm sorry. After the movie, we got what was left of the fifth season that started airing before the movie came out, an epilogue bonus episode, and then some weird beef jerky commercials, as well as a five-part series called Chick Figures. Yeah, I think season 5 in the movie may have been a more graceful way to go out. I don't really like that the two main characters, Red and Blue's final scenes, are about beef jerky, especially after such an emotional ending to the film. Normally, I'll talk about these web shows one installment at a time, but honestly, the five seasons of the show are pretty consistent, and they don't really stand out from one another that much. The movie warrants its own segment, and we'll get back to that, but I'm just gonna kind of skim through the series for now, so let's take several steps backwards and check out the first episode of Dick Figures.
What is wrong with your body?
Hey, Blue, how you do?
What is wrong with your voice?
There ain't nothing wrong with my voice, shawty.
Oh, no.
I'm having girl problems.
Then I feel bad for you, son.
My girlfriend dumped me last night.
Oh, my God.
Thanks, man.
No.
Yeah, I know. We were together.
Oh, shit.
You sound really stupid.
Yeah, right. My
voice sounds tight as fuck. Oh, this is making me fucking sick.
Yeah!
Shorty, make that ass crap.
Huh. No, I'm not allowed to laugh at this. Yeah, this is pretty rough. I mean, I kind of already gave you an idea of what the humor was at the start of this video, but God, this is pretty rough around the edges. Do any of these episodes hold up? Well, as of right now, I've rewatched 20 of them, and I really liked 2 of them. So yeah, 2 so far. The episode Where Cops honestly has a pretty funny premise, with Red stealing a cop car and taking Blue on a joyride with him as they lie about being police officers and consistently take advantage of the power that comes with that. Eventually they get in way over their heads, and they attempt to rob a bank, which leads to an ending that to this day I still find really funny.
It's alright! We're cops!
It's cool! They're cops!
They're cops!
They're cops!
They're cops!
They're cops!
Cops!
Yeah, we're cops!
Woo!
We're cops!
Cops is what we are!
We're cops too!
Look at us, we're all cops!
That's pretty good, I'll give them that. The other episode I really like is the season 2 finale titled Bath Rhymes, which is a music video made by the creators and the fans of the show. The song is relatively catchy and a lot of the submissions from fans are pretty great. I mean, even the lower quality entries are charming, like it all contributes to making just this really nice handmade project. It's kind of like Shrek Retold in that sense, where you'll jump from something animated by a professional to something that's either being done by someone who's kind of new to it or intentionally making a shitpost. I think that the music video is edited very well too, and I'll go into more detail why I think that later when we talk about their second music video in season 5. This one has a lot of standout moments too, like this one shot that was done by the late Ed Gold, the creator of Ed's World. I didn't notice it at first, but if you really look at it, not only did Ed give himself a cameo in the background, but that right there is very much an Ed's World expression. I love it. There's also just a lot of variety in the art styles being taken on. Sometimes they'll draw Red and Blue as actual people, sometimes they'll mix in some highly edited live action footage, there's a claymation shot, and then the entire thing throws you off by providing animation that is on the same level as a fucking Disney movie.
I got that ass in my lap!
Now make that ass crap!
Holy shit, who did that shot? Well, actually I know, because I subscribe to his channel on YouTube. Aaron Humminston is an animator who doesn't have a lot of web content of his own, but that's not really what he's focused on. I mean, this is a guy who's been in the industry for some time now, and it's easy to see why. He clearly understands animation really well. There was a fan art episode of Bob's Burgers that he tried to make an animation for, and it looked amazing, and then... But hey, now the guy actually does work for Bob's Burgers and posts some of his work and the process on his channel. So seriously, check it out, it's really impressive. All in all, I think everyone involved in this project did an outstanding job, and I really do salute the creators for putting this together. It was one of the first animation clubs I ever saw, and I always thought it was an awesome idea since then. As for the other 18 episodes, I can at least see the appeal for other people and my former self. I just think I've outgrown a lot of it. It kind of feels like I'm looking at a mirror of myself. Me laughing at this would be the equivalent of me laughing at my own videos from 2010. It's just
not happening, y'all.
Still, every episode stood out on its own. They did use a lot of tropey stories, like doing a zombie episode or doing a Star Wars episode, but they rarely ever repeat any of these tropes. Each episode goes for something a little different, which I can appreciate. It's kind of like watching the sketchpad you used in class when you weren't paying attention come to life. It's immature, but that's quite literally what it has to be. So within these first 20 episodes, we meet all of our main slash reoccurring characters. Red and Blue are the ones at the center of all of it, and they're pretty one note. Blue is lame and Red is obnoxious. I think ultimately what you have is a show about a toxic friendship. Red and Blue get themselves into horrible situations, Red normally being the cause, but Blue never really stopping him. Sometimes Blue is fully on board, and sometimes Blue is against what is happening, but he's never in control of the situation like Red. Red has every single obnoxious trait that a person can have. He's loud, he's mean, he's a womanizer, he's greedy, he's inconsiderate, he's gross, he's violent, he's an idiot. But people typically have fun when they're around him, as long as they're not his enemy. Blue, on the other hand, has every single dorky trait a person can have. He's awkward, he's a pushover, he's insecure, he's a huge nerd, he lacks charisma, he's boring, but he is generally a good person. Despite being the butt of the joke more often than not, and not nearly as popular as Red, he normally does serve as a voice of reason. He is shown to be a lot smarter than Red, and while most of the characters on the show shit on him, the few relationships he does have do seem to be positive ones in the grand scheme of things. Like, there's people who like Blue. There's not really one who likes Red, he's just fun to be around for a short period of time. His loyalty to Red is explored more in the movie, where we learn it's more due to Red saving his life as a child than any genuine connection the two shared. So you've got a pretty common duo for comedies, especially a comedy about two bros in college. But I do think that the movie helps evolve these two a little bit better, and gives the show more purpose. As I said, the show is about a toxic friendship, but I really only see it in that way because of how the movie explores it. Yes, Blue isn't treated very well by Red in the web show, but with how short the episodes are, and with their focus being more on jokes than character or story, you're not really going to think that deeply about these two. But when you consider all these episodes as just short clips from the lives of the two characters in the movie, you can paint a more clear picture of who they are. There is more effort put into these two characters than you might think. And I can see why they struck a chord of so many people, again, myself included. Now for side characters and reoccurring characters, well, I think the first big one to mention would be the raccoon, which is just them wanting to throw in a character with a heavy accent. This is becoming more and more of a dying bit these days, I guess. Doing an accent is something that I really say only recently has been frowned upon. Comedies have been doing this forever, even in the 2010s, it was still a very common thing. I mean, you can be critical of this if it makes you uncomfortable, but everyone did it. Hell, even I did it when I copied this character for my own show with a talking panda.
Well then, you see, here's the thing. I am the one with guns and assassins. So either way, you are going to do this job for me.
Why was he Russian? That doesn't even make sense. The raccoon contributes very little outside of some story significance in the movie. Honestly, despite me copying the character, he was never one that I enjoyed that much. However, I did like Lord Tourette's, who's potentially a more offensive character. Thing with him, though, is I think there is humor outside of them making light of a real condition people have. Lord Tourette's delivery is just funny, going from his super cheerful voice to this very aggressive voice.
A tweedlecock and a tweedleballs! Pony sparkles, bubblegum. Little fairies in my
butt, Nazi ass thunder, beaver-carrying toad douche in my mouth!
I feel like honestly you could do the same bit today, but just make it more of a Unikitty situation. Which hey, one of the show's creator went to work on. There's your fun fact of the day. I'm not gonna tell people how to feel about this character. If it makes you feel uncomfortable, I don't think that's you being too sensitive, I have no ground to tell anyone that. But I will say what I like about the character is one, they're probably the only sweet character on the show. I mean, they have a lot of really fucked up moments. But for the most part, Lord Tourette's is the sweetheart of the show, which is a nice contrast from these two. And like I said, the delivery is just pretty funny. Lord Tourette's cheerful voice makes me laugh, and his angry voice is really one of a kind. A cheerful character having a sudden change in tone is nothing new, but the difference between these two voices is night and day.
Because France's favorite meal is
dead baby Nazi ass cheese power fart!
There's Pink, and she's really just there to be Blue's girlfriend, and that's about it. She occasionally gets an episode where she gets to do something funny, but most of her humor comes from Blue being foiled by Red, like him screwing up one of their dates. I also just don't like her sometimes. Like, often she gets mad at Blue over something that isn't going right, but like, 90% of the time it's not even his fault, and she's a witness to it not being his fault, and she still gets angry at him for it.
Stacy is a little better. She's essentially the female Red, so she does get to have funny lines of her own. She is kind of there to be Red's girl, but she honestly works a lot better with Red. She feels like she's part of the joke. If you find Red funny, you'll likely find Stacy funny too. Characters like Brosif, Mr. Dingleberry, and Jason are all reoccurring, but have even less personality than the ones mentioned before. Brosif is a douchebag, Mr. Dingleberry is an old man, and Jason is just there to reference memes. He always has a rage comic face. Part of me finds that exceptionally obnoxious, and another part of me thinks that makes the show feel like more of a time capsule, which can make it more interesting to look back at one day. But I don't find the character especially funny. In fact, I kind of dread the episodes where he's a main character. There's a few more characters in the movie we can talk about later, but the only other one I'll mention now is a character who's literally named Fat Ugly Girl. Like, that's her name on the wiki. She's only here for this one running joke where Red tells her to go home in a very stern voice.
I just found you a new girlfriend, and a girl for your girlfriend.
And you can go home.
It's mean, but it's also very in character for Red to do something like that. You're definitely supposed to view Red as a dick in the series. Ha. The only reason I bring her up at all is because she has significance in the finale. Outside of that, it's just really the same running joke with her. Jason has a thing for her, and in the movie it's revealed that she's Stacy's sister. There you go. As we move into the second half of the show, I actually think some of these episodes hold up a little bit better, as in I actually have something to say about some of them. I think that they were starting to get more comfortable with the series as they started to do more of the animation. For example, the season 3 premiere does this Batman parody with a lot of fighting. It's kind of that watching your school doodles come to life thing I said earlier. Like, finding a minimalistic way to do something fun. I think that the writing has become wittier here too.
Your name makes you sound like loser.
What? No, it's because I'm blue and I'm a total bruiser. Loser.
The second episode of season 3 has all the guy characters playing poker and sharing a story from their past, trying to one-up the other. Depending on who's telling the story, there might be a slightly different art style. The raccoon tells his backstory, which they actually reuse for the movie. It's actually funny how much of what he says here comes back for the movie. I never really noticed that when I used to watch the show. This one's pretty funny too. It has some abrupt moments that get a laugh out of me.
So sick! It was like no big deal. I got like a good 100 reps. It was chill.
And I like maintained a perfect boner the whole time.
In the third episode, Red gets really into character at a Halloween party where he's dressed as the Terminator, where he has some pretty out of character moments, consistently losing the chance to get laid in order to find Sarah Connor. I like this one too. So far, season 3 is looking a lot better. It also seems that these episodes are getting slightly longer, which gives them just a little bit more time to have structure, which I think helps a lot. For example, a season 1 episode of Dick Figures is Red being drunk and saying weird things for 2 minutes, the episode ends. Or there's this one episode where something weird happens, but then it's revealed it was a dream the whole time, but then something else weird happens, but it's revealed that was also a dream, and we just keep doing this until the 2 minutes are up. While a season 3 episode has a story where Pink spills a drink in Blue's face because he doesn't like her Halloween costume, so he starts to hook up with someone who's being a lot nicer to him, but then that is foiled by Red's side story about being stuck in character as the Terminator, as Pink out of jealousy tells Red that that girl is Sarah Connor, so Red does what he must and defeats Sarah Connor, ultimately cock-blocking Blue. It's a story of a beginning, middle, and ending, but it's still able to be fast-paced and ridiculous like the first 2 seasons of Dick Figures. However, now it's better at utilizing its cast of characters and allowing things to happen for a reason rather than just being random. The fourth episode is, okay, that's Jason. Okay, back to skimming. Actually, this one has its moments too, like Red throwing a gun and then pulling the trigger by shooting it with another gun, or the constant achievements showing up at the bottom of the screen. And like, it's subtle too. They don't have a character shout out the achievements or make it take up a ton of the screen. It's very brief. You could miss it, and I appreciate that. It's not to say that the first 2 seasons didn't have any good bits. In fact, I mentioned episodes I liked from the first 2 seasons. But it just kind of feels like there's more thought being put into the jokes here. A lot more visual jokes, a lot of the dialogue's better. A lot of season 1 really did just feel like Red being obnoxious, Blue was annoyed by Red. Let's keep moving forward. Let's see if it maintains this. This is great. They do a body swap episode, which has some good laughs, but I wish they would have had Red and Blue switch voices too. I think part of the fun of this trope is hearing one voice actor try to sound like a different character. But no, Red still has his voice in Blue's body, which doesn't even really make sense. I've seen a lot of cartoons take this route. I hate it when they do that. If they switch bodies, they should have the other character's voice. It also hurts some of the jokes in the episode, like Red calling Pink and Blue's body, but like, she's only hearing the voice, so she shouldn't be falling for it. They do a secret agent boat episode. This one has one of the show's half-assed covers, and I mean that in the best way. Every once in a while, they'll just cover a song, but the person singing it always sounds like he's phoning it in, and it's hilarious.
Raindrops keep falling on my red. Oh, that doesn't mean my eyes will soon be turning red.
I'm drunk off pina coladas, sailing out of the bay.
Earl Grey's last living minion is the villain of this episode. That's a fun little piece of continuity. Look at you guys. They do a Titanic bit in this episode, but for Jack and Rose, they just reuse their Bella and Jacob, and honestly, it took a lame joke and made it funny. I just like the idea of whenever they're gonna do a tropey romance, they're just gonna use the same two characters. In the finale, Blue goes to a Chinese restaurant with Pink, where in order to eat, they have to prove that they're a Kung Fu master. So Blue, of course, gets Red to do it, and we get a pretty great fighting sequence. This is probably the most impressive episode of the show to date, and it's exactly what I'm talking about when I say the show does as much as it can with stick figures. I'd even say so far that each season does a great job giving it their all in the finale. Season 1 ended on a big Star Wars episode, season 2 ended on the animation collab, and this one ends on a big kung fu battle. It always ends on a high note. Season 4 starts off with more of the same, really. The second episode has Blue asking Red for advice on how to keep things interesting with Pink, and it has a pretty great ending. In the fourth episode, we meet Red's pet octopus, Ocho Muerte. This is another episode that is pretty relevant to the movie, as Ocho Muerte is a pretty major part of the film's climax. Granted, this episode is kind of retconned. Ocho Muerte's backstory in the movie kind of goes against him being Red's pet in this episode, and Red doesn't even seem to recognize him in the movie. Honestly, though, I like the movie's version more. This episode is fine though. I'm getting closer to the second half of season 4, and while I would still consider it a step above 1 and 2, it feels like a step down from season 3. I felt season 3 episodes had better jokes and better narratives. Season 4 has its moments though. The following episode, First Day of Cool, was actually the first 5 minutes of the movie, essentially being a pitch for the movie. Not long after this episode, the Kickstarter was launched. I'll say this episode did a great job selling people on the movie, as it really stepped up the production. As I mentioned before, the backgrounds are a lot nicer and the stick figures' heads are filled in so they blend in better with these more complicated backgrounds. They'll also blur in and out certain aspects of the shot to make it look more cinematic. On top of that, there's a lot more angles to the shots. The shading looks great, the movement is a lot more smooth. It's hands down the best fight scene in the show so far, but it's almost unfair to compare them. It was a really great approach to getting this movie made, and the movie would start to become a major priority. The second half of season 4 would get released before the movie, and even the first 3 episodes of season 5, but there would be some really long hiatuses, as their focus really was on getting this movie finished. The Kickstarter, while a success, did make me raise an eyebrow a bit. They wanted $250,000 to make a special 30-minute episode with the same quality as the First Day of Cool short, $500,000 to make an hour-long short film, and $700,000 for a feature film. They made $313,411, which would have been $313,436 if my goddamn gift card got accepted. But despite this, they went for the feature film anyways. On one hand, what a Chad move getting that feature film made despite not reaching their goal. A 30-minute short just would not have been as exciting in comparison to a feature film. On the other hand, did you fucking lie to us? What a jump. We need $700,000 to make a feature film. Fine, a little over $300,000 will do. I mean, that's not even half of what you needed. I mean, maybe we would have been looking at a full hour and a half if that $700,000 goal was met, but in terms of quality of the animation, I don't see any shortcuts here. They did a great job with this. Was there a voice actor they couldn't get because of this, or were the animators doing a lot of overtime? They said they ended up putting a lot of their own money into the film, and that's very admirable. Hell, everything about this movie is admirable. The animation team got to animate themselves into the credits doing whatever they wanted. That's a lot more appreciation than animators normally get. They released the movie on time and consistently gave people updates. There was a lot of behind the scenes videos and streams leading up to the movie. There was almost nothing sketchy about the Kickstarter at all. People loved the movie. The voice actors, new and old, all did great. The movie looks good. The budget feels justified. This is such a great outcome that I can't say that this is a call out. I've just always been baffled by the additional $400,000 they said they needed. Maybe it would have just made things easier for them. Maybe they really did pour a shitload of their own money into the project. But I mean, these guys are making cartoons for Mondo Media. I don't think they had $400,000 lying around. My guess is that $700,000 would have made the process a lot more easy and secure, but the movie was possible with a smaller budget. But they told the audience that it wasn't in hopes that would motivate them to donate. Still, despite the eyebrow raise, I have nothing but respect for these guys for getting the movie out the way they did with the budget they had. It's very impressive, and as far as I know, no one working on it had a bad experience with the project. That is a success story if I've ever heard one. Back to season 4, there's an episode called Freshman 15 where Red tries to bang 15 freshman chicks. It's another one that utilizes its cast of characters pretty well, and it has a line or two that I like. It even has some interesting animation in this one. It gets really trippy at points. But I'm not gonna lie, I think this one maybe goes a step too far. I feel like this is an episode that you have to ignore entirely if you're going to accept Red as a decent guy in the finale, which is hard to do because the movie not only acknowledges this episode, but plays footage from it. I think it's another example of you wouldn't be able to make this episode today. Lord Tourette's gets his own episode where he tells the story of the first time he had sex. It's really sweet and heartwarming, followed by it being the most gruesome thing ever explained to anyone. Again, I think it's something that's all in the delivery, both the way that LT is animated and voiced makes this funny. I also like how long his outburst is in this one. They're normally just a word or two, a sentence at the most, but with this one it's the entire ending of the episode. I recall back when the show was still going, the creators of the show did a little character tournament to see who the audience favorite was. Round one was kind of bullshit because you have main characters like Blue and Lord Tourette's going up against one-off characters, some of which that don't even have lines. As they got further, it was narrowed down to the top four, which was Red, Blue, Lord Tourette's, and Stacy. Stacy is the only one that surprised me here, and honestly, if it wasn't for the fact that she went up against Mr. Dingleberry and Red went up against the raccoon, it probably would have been the raccoon in the top four, but I like Stacy more than the raccoon, so I'm happy with this top four. I think the most surprising thing about this tournament, however, and the whole reason I bring it up while talking about the Lord Tourette's episode, is Lord Tourette's actually managed to beat Red in the final round. So officially, Lord Tourette's is the fan favorite of the show, and honestly, I might agree with that. Like I said, it making light of Tourette's syndrome is something that probably is gonna rub someone the wrong way, but I'd be lying if I said I didn't get why people liked this guy so much. For all I know, there's people with Tourette's who would love this character. He's treated as a friend by the group, at least as much as this group is willing to treat someone like a friend. He's helpful and competent. He clearly struck a chord with the fans of the show. Out of all the side characters, he's probably the one that gets the biggest scene in the movie. He's just a joyful slash fucked up little guy. I won't tell anyone how to feel about him, but I get why people like him. They do another Batman episode, and honestly, I think the show does a lot better when they don't go back to older ideas. Like, come on, we already did this. You didn't even make a new villain, it's just Earl Grey again. Move on to something else. In the season 4 finale, we get an episode that was probably supposed to be the final one before the movie came out. It's actually a prequel to the first episode of Dick Figures, where Blue's girlfriend breaks up with him. You think throughout the episode it's going to be Pink, but then it's actually revealed to be Stacy. In the very first episode of the show, Blue is trying to tell Red about how his girlfriend just left him, so that checks out. And this finale ends with Red swallowing the bee that makes his voice auto-tuned. Yeah, that's a thing. It doesn't really happen that much, but the bee itself normally makes some sort of appearance every season, often just shouting out the season that you're currently watching. Pretty small scale in comparison to the other three finales, but still a special episode with it taking place at the very start of the show. It even ends with Blue saying he's gonna go see a movie, which was in fact a tease at the now-funded Dick Figures movie. I believe the movie was probably intended to be the next release, but they had the first three episodes of season 5 completed, so they just put them out there. And honestly, I think it's probably better to talk about season 5 before the movie. Season 5, with the exception of the finale, feels like it's supposed to take place before the movie, as a big part of the movie is Red becoming a better friend to Blue, and he feels like his old self in these final episodes. Season 5's premiere is pretty decent. One notable thing about it is that it uses music from the movie, which I'll definitely need to take a minute to talk about once I'm on the movie. The composer for the entire series is Nick Keller, co-creator of the show and voice of Blue's brother, Zach Keller. His music in the series has always been really fitting for what Dick Figures is, but his score in the movie honestly goes pretty hard. I'm a fan of it. More on that in a bit. The second episode has one of my favorite Red moments ever, where he goes into a bank with a gun to make a deposit.
Nobody move! This is a deposit!
I like how this episode is almost framed as if it's gonna be whoever can go the longest without curse and wins a bet, but Red immediately loses the bet, so it actually becomes an episode about him having to do all of Blue's chores. I'm coming to learn that some of Dick Figures actually has aged fairly well. It's pretty unbearable when it's an episode that hasn't aged well, but where I really only enjoyed two episodes from the first two seasons, I think I've ended up enjoying 10 to 15 of the later seasons, with others mostly just being average. There really aren't many that I've hated. Even rough episodes like Freshman 15 have a funny line or interesting shot. Snow Job is a funny one. Red is on the other side for once, with Blue and Pink being his foil.
Alright, come on, dude.
I'm here, Red.
Hey, use the log, not the twig! Use the log! Take it out!
The fourth episode was the first one released after the movie, and to celebrate, they did another music video collab. The band Ninja Sex Party did the song for the movie's credits, and they thought it would be fun to make that song into another music video. So they once again reached out to the fans and got a bunch of submissions. With the movie being funded by the fans and Ninja Sex Party being a pretty popular band at the time, this was a very nice gesture to the fan base. And all in all, I did enjoy this one too, although I will say this is where we need to discuss the importance of editing. Compare and contrast the Bathrams music video to the Dick Figures the Movie music video. One is a song that felt like it was created for a music video collab, and one feels like it was meant to play at the end of a movie. The significance is one lended itself to editing to the beat better, that one being Bathrams. Now that doesn't mean you can't find a rhythm to edit to with the movie song, but it's definitely more so taking advantage of the band they got for it, rather than finding a song that would work better for the collab. I still, however, think it could have panned out better with more entries or at least longer entries. I don't think you have to be an expert on editing to see why one is better than the other here. Let me play you a little bit of Bath Rhymes. Take a look at how well the shots are edited to the music.
Shorty, make that booty clap. Put that butt into my lap. Cruising down these ghetto streets. Jamming to my dubstep.
too. Yeah, right, I'm a robot guy. Shoot lasers out of my eyes. The dingleberry says to me,
shut the fuck up.
Now let's take a look at the movie song and tell me if you think it's edited nearly as well. If you don't see what I'm talking about, it's cutting way too fast, and more often than not, it's not even cutting to the beat of the music very well. Again, Bath Rhymes was an easier song to edit for sure, but it wasn't impossible to do it with this song. On top of all that, it feels like more people reached out for Bath Rhymes. Like I said, we had some more notable people involved, like Ed Gould. There are some really nice entries in this collab, but I've gotta say a lot more of them feel like younger fans submitting stuff. And don't get me wrong, I think them allowing entries of all experience levels is really awesome. Like, there's gotta be some people who helped with this music video that kept at it because of their involvement in this. It can be really inspiring not only to get to do a shot for your favorite web show, but a shot in a popular band's music video. Like, this was around the time that Danny joined Game Grumps, and Game Grumps was a pretty huge channel at this point. So there was all kinds of notoriety with this collab. It would have been awesome to have a shot in it. But I do think you need to strike more of a balance. Bath Rhymes had that. This one mainly feels like its entries coming from people who are new to animating. Honestly, if it weren't for the opening of the music video, it wouldn't even feel official. But even then, that's not even what the big problem here is. Because if it was all edited together very well, it still would have worked. I've learned a little bit about splitting up a shot list from some of 3GI's behind the scenes videos, when talking about Shrek Retold or Sonic Rebuilt, and I think this music video would have benefited from requesting longer shots from the people submitting stuff. I know you don't want to ask someone to take on too much when it's a collaboration project like this one, but surely longer than 1 second would be good. Unless it's a part of the song where the cuts need to happen really quickly. Honestly, with this music video, it cuts a lot quicker, but it's a slower paced song than Bath Rhymes. Like, the shot should be cutting slower in this one. It still has a whole pretty charming video that I do enjoy, but I feel like they just did it so much better on their first go. Honestly, if the rest of season 5, it just starts to get a little dull for me. More of the same, really. Nothing really stands out to me. The official final episode of the series is Red and Blue need to take a shit but can't find a toilet, but then make it back to their apartment only for there to be a surprise party, which causes both of them to shit themselves. If you ignore the finale, the show ends with Red and Blue shitting themselves. Now you might be saying, well, of course I'm not going to ignore the finale. Why would I ignore the finale? Well, in order to watch the finale, you have to purchase the entire season digitally. Buying the entire season of Dick Figures digitally doesn't really make any sense, since the episodes are all on YouTube for free. But as a bonus, they threw in the final episode of the show, an episode that takes place after the movie and offers a conclusion to every character, as a season 5 digital purchase exclusive. Why the fuck did you do this, Mondo Media? Again, having a digital copy of the season means nothing. If it was a physical copy and there were bonus features, then sure, but no, the whole show is on YouTube for free. It's still on YouTube for free. You're asking me to buy the entire season just to watch a 3-minute finale to the series? That is so lame. I would go as far as to say it's a ripoff. But you know what? If it was just some random episode, I would still call it stupid, but okay, at least it's just one perk to buying the season digitally, I guess. But it's not just some random episode. It's the fucking ending to your series. I bet you that a lot of people who watched this back then didn't even know this episode existed. I mean, it was barely promoted anywhere. The only reason I found out about it is because when I like a piece of media, I fixate on the tiniest details that probably don't fucking matter at all. If you haven't noticed, I don't know how you would have noticed that personally, watching this fucking channel. Okay, I'm gonna calm down, this is getting obnoxious. But yeah, to those who wanted to pay, the ending of Dick Figures is a follow-up to the movie where we finally see Red and Blue grow up and move on in their lives, becoming better people in the process. If you didn't want to pay, the ending of Dick Figures is Red and Blue shitting themselves. Pick your poison, they're both fine endings, I assure you. Okay, to be fair, it is $3 for HD and $2 for SD. I don't know if it was always that cheap, I don't remember, but a while back I did purchase it and I have it. Part of me just wants to play the episode in its entirety because of how stupid it is that they charge for their final episode. But I guess I don't want to be that disrespectful to the people who made this show, even if I do think that was a stupid decision. If you look hard enough, you can find it, that's all I'll say. Hey, don't look at me like that, this show taught me to steal. Without a further to do, let's talk about how they wrapped up the show with the Dick Figures movie and the final episode, Figured Out. Dick Figures the movie is about as good as an adaptation as you could ever expect. And I do mean adaptation and not movie. As a movie, it's solid enough. It's well animated, as I mentioned before, has a story that flows well, voices are all fairly well done. 6 out of 10, I'd say. As for adapting the source material, it goes above and beyond, really evolving Red and Blue's characters. As an adaptation of the web show, it's like a 9 or a 10. This is the part where I seem really pretentious to my audience. audience and they're just like, just give it a fucking 10 then, you asshole. I appreciate art. Dick figures qualifies as art, but it's like a little, you know, it's on the middle. It's fine, it's on the middle. It's not at the very bottom with like what? Mean, I saw the Mean one recently. Horrible, horrible fucking movie. I think any good film adaptation of a series should find an interesting angle, something relevant to the show that has never been fully explored. This could be Louise having insecurities about her rabbit ears, Homer's family questioning why they put up with him, SpongeBob and Patrick accepting that being a kid is nothing to be ashamed of, etc., etc. The Dick Figures movie does find this angle by exploring not only why Blue would want to be friends with Fred, but also exploring the possibility of them actually becoming good friends by the end of it. We open with the first day of Cool Shore with some minor adjustments made. It truly is a fun scene and does give you a good idea of why Blue would want to be friends with this guy. From what he saw, it seemed like Red was willing to save his life. What we see in the following montage and the first new scene of this movie is that throughout their entire lives, Red was not a good friend to Blue. Blue is being taken advantage of and isn't entirely blind to it, but keeps using the fact that Red saved his life as a sign that their friendship does mean something. This is not only a great scene with music that fits the scene really well, but it's also a great way to introduce someone who hasn't seen the show to these characters. If you haven't watched the web show, it's not news to you that Red isn't a good friend, but this scene conveys what 40 plus episodes of a web series conveyed in 1 minute. A lot of great details in this opening montage. You can see a lot of Pink's past relationships and also her grown tired of being around these types of people, which fits well with this movie actually allowing these two to have a good relationship. Not a super interesting or well explored relationship, mind you, but neither of them are being shitty to each other. That's progress. Red and Lord Tourette's hats being thrown during the graduation was a nice touch. After this, we're all caught up to modern times, where we learn of Blue's main dilemma. He needs to get Pink a birthday present. Him and Red go to see the raccoon, who promises Blue the best gift Pink has ever received if he retrieves a sword from his past. A lot of his backstory that's told here is the exact story he told in the episode I mentioned earlier, so this isn't coming out of nowhere, and while this maybe is kind of a forced way to get the story moving, there is a lot more purpose to the journey. The purpose being Blue is trying to prove himself and others that he can pull off such a quest. With how the situation with the bullies went at the start of the film, and the teasing that he receives from both Pink and Red in the first modern scene of the movie, this all checks out. I think the film's story mostly flows really well. The quest has a lot of fun scenes, each of which really could have been their own episode. There's a scene where they're traveling through Japan, a dungeon with booby traps, they get stuck on a deserted island, there's a plane sequence of a blind pilot, there's a chase scene. All these are scenes that are very at home with the web series. Where the real heart of the Dick Figures movie comes from, however, is how they deal with Red and Blue's friendship. After they collect the first part of the sword, as it's revealed the sword is split up around the world in three pieces, Red and Blue get stranded at sea, where a very telling conversation takes place.
Red, not every girl in the world thinks you're cool, hot shit.
Yeah, they do. Why do you think I beat up all those bullies back in kindergarten?
To save my life?
What? No! Dude, I was trying to impress all those chicks.
What?
Yeah, worked pretty good, too.
You've beaten me up, embarrassed me, screwed my ex-girlfriends, crapped in my bed, stolen my shit, eaten my food, and taken my money for years. And I stayed friends with you this whole time because for some reason, I actually thought you were my friend too!
Well, you must feel pretty stupid.
From this point on, their friendship is over, and over the course of the rest of the movie, we slowly see them start to get over their fight, but also form a more genuine friendship. Red is still a dick for most of the movie, and Blue on multiple occasions shows that he clearly still wants to be friends with Red. But we do start to see Red compliment Blue, we see Blue stick up for himself a bit more, and by the end of the movie we get some surprisingly genuine moments between the two. It's weird seeing Red talk the way he does, I'm not gonna lie. I've heard some people call this unearned, and I could see why they would feel that way after watching Red be a jerk for not only most of this movie, but the entire series, but I think what helps it is them avoiding the very frustrating act of returning to the status quo. Red apologizes to Blue at the end of the movie, he actually wants to be his friend by the end of it, and this is not undone. This is permanent. Now, this being pretty damn close to the end of the series definitely helps them stick to that, but I think knowing where to end is something that you can compliment. I mean, Dick Figures could have kept going for multiple seasons after this, with Red seemingly learning nothing from the movie. They could have just undone it. I've seen a lot of movies do that. Where the fuck is the Krusty Krab 2? It's the series finale. They referenced the movie in the show. You can't lie to me. With them wrapping up things after this, I think the movie does a great job of not only evolving these two, but giving them a satisfying conclusion for the entire series. series. So how do the other characters hold up in this movie? The raccoon actually has some story significance to the film, so I think I like him a lot more here than I do in the show. He contributes more than just a silly accent in the movie. I actually got a few chuckles out of him for once. In the scene where he's telling his backstory, it cuts back to him sleeping instead of red and blue. That's actually a pretty decent joke. There's this line he has in the show that became a running bit, and it's not really one that I ever found all that clever or funny, but I kind of do like how they used it in this movie.
I can go all night, baby. I'm a nocturnal.
You really think you can defeat all of us? Didn't you know I can go all night, baby? I'm nocturnal.
I also really like the scene where he's talking to his father in a flashback, where we learn of what his dreams were.
If you ever want to fight evil, you must keep your elbow straight.
Father, one day I want to go to America.
That is not a country yet.
Lord Tourette's is designated to one part of the movie, but he gets a ton of lines and screen time during that part. Honestly, the scenes in Paris might be the best in the entire movie, and I would say that he does contribute to a bit of my enjoyment. Pink I don't get a ton from here, but she isn't really bad either. She feels like more of a plot device than an actual character. Like, Blue cares about her, so we're also supposed to care about her. I do really like the joke though, where she's holding Blue's photo and it blows off into the wind, and then the same thing happens when she's looking at a picture of him on her computer. That was funny. Stacy, Brosif, Dingleberry, and Jason are more so cameo characters. I mean, Brosif and Stacy get a good chunk in the opening, but we already saw that. Their scenes outside of that are really minimal, but you can understand why. This movie chooses who to focus on pretty well. Dingleberry has some significance to the story, but in terms of screen time, he really doesn't get that much. Then we have two new characters, Lord Takagami and Captain Crookiegrin. Lord Takagami serves as the film's main antagonist, and he's honestly a pretty funny villain.
Seize their souls! From our point of view, they are the villains, not us! It's totally rational from our side of the story!
He's a big part of the raccoon's backstory and wants to collect the sword for himself so he can fulfill his mission of avenging every person who's ever died, including people who've died of old age and people he's killed. It's such a stupid motivation that it cracks me up. On top of that, there are some really out there plot reveals with this guy near the end of the movie. I won't spoil them, as I always want to give people who watch these some motivation to go and actually watch the show I'm talking about, but it gets really stupid. But I mean that in a good way. They have more than one major reveal about who he actually is within 5 minutes. It's great. Captain Crookiegrin is also a pretty enjoyable character. I don't even know if I'm saying his name right. That's what I typed out. That's what his name is. He saves Red and Blue from the island they get stuck on, while also being the one who was hired to hunt them down. Luckily for them, he is an alcoholic who is suffering from alcohol blindness. However, he's slowly regaining his sight as he becomes sober, so Red gets him drunk while Blue fights off the jetpack-equipped ninjas. Again, perfect adaptation of the show. This is the exact type of thing that the web show would have been doing. I've already talked about a lot of the decisions they made to make the whole thing feel more cinematic, but another scene I really want to bring attention to is that fantastic chase sequence. They mix their regular 2D animation with 3D models, but with the simple textures they use for backgrounds, it all blended together really well, creating what, in my opinion, is the most impressive scene of the entire series. Experimenting with 3D really allowed them to get some shots that weren't possible in the series before. Of course, drawing with stick figures is a shortcut, but consider this. There were not a lot of animators on this project. The main animation team consisted of 11 people, with 3 people being credited for additional animation. That is exceptionally low for an animated film. I think the only aspect of the movie that could have used work would be Ochimowete. Like I said before, he plays a role in the movie more so towards the ending, and I would say it's the only thing in this movie that looks cheap by Dick figure standards. Like, instead of actually drawing this giant squid out, they created a model of Riggs to animate it. At certain angles, it looks decent, but whenever it talks, this looks really cheap. I'm giving this movie a lot of props for its art. I'm giving the stick figures movie a lot of props for its art. When it's this bad, I gotta be honest about it. That looks terrible. Perhaps this is something that would have looked better if they got more money during the Kickstarter. If only they got my $25. If only they got my fucking $25, this whole scene would have been different. This would have been Ghibli-style animation with the fucking squid. Actually, if you take a look at the art book, it actually does explain that Ochimowete was going to be a papier-mâché with, like, these big marionette tentacles and light-up eyes. They were going to film it in front of a green screen. This is more of a time-constraint thing. So yeah, I mean, you can kind of see where the budget cuts came in, I guess. But it's a neat idea that they had for it. Also, while I'm mentioning gripes, let me talk about one scene in the movie that I don't think works very well near the end of it. As Red and Blue start to rekindle their friendship, they decided to throw in one more scene to have them split up, only for them to regroup at the end. That is a pretty typical trope, but this is Dick figures that we're talking about. Doing tropes is kind of their thing. But it's just so forced here. Like, it happens within seconds.
Sup, boys?
spacey. I see two mountains right here.
Oh crap, not now. Dude, we don't have time for this.
She can wait a little bit. That gem hasn't gone anywhere for like a billion years.
I don't know why I ever trusted you. You never followed through on anything. This is the most important thing that's ever happened to me in your bailing?
I could almost see them doing this as a joke, but it doesn't feel very ironic here at all. It does lead into the epic montage song where we see Red regretting his decision to abandon Blue. And this scene is funny, and this scene does have jokes. It more so feels like this scene was included so they could include this scene. But I think they needed to take the breakup scene a little slower, because without it being played as a joke, and it being a more dramatic scene in the movie, it feels like they're forcing conflict into the film. Again, if it was being done for a joke within the scene, I'd give it a pass because it's the Dick Figures movie. I don't need, like, this great drama in the Dick Figures movie. But they play it pretty straight, so it's just weird. Again, maybe it was a budget thing. If only they had my $25! Shit! The only other thing I want to mention before moving on to the finale is the score by Nick Keller. Most of his music for Dick Figures is electronic music. Techno, house, dubstep. There's a lot of that in Dick Figures, and a lot of that in the movie as well. And I actually think the movie has some of the better electronic tracks of the entire show. But on top of that, the movie throws in a lot of cinematic sound and music. With the bigger story, it makes sense that they would want to try to have a more diverse score. And I think the music in this movie accompanies the scenes very well. The scene where Blue learns about how Red really feels about him has eerie music that builds up into something more dramatic as the two get into a fight. I already mentioned that I really enjoy the music of the opening scene, but to try to explain what I like about it, I think that it is very upbeat and energetic as the two grow up and get excited for their futures, but there's also just a bit of a somber feeling to it, as we see Red consistently taking advantage of Blue and not acting like a good friend to him. In fact, the very start of their friendship starts with this very upbeat sound, only for it to settle down almost instantly as Blue starts to see what his friendship with Red is actually going to be like.
I know. 'Cause I'm awesome!
There's a theme for their adventure that is reoccurring throughout the film and can fit a variety of emotions. It might be used for a triumph scene as the two get themselves out of a horrible situation or succeed at something huge, or it could be used for a more emotional scene, like when Red finally does right by his friend that he's treated poorly for so long. The ending track is also really nice, fit in the more heartwarming moments of Blue and Pink's reunion as well as the raccoon reuniting with his wife, building back into something more intense and inspirational as Red and Blue repeat their dialogue from the start of the film, now with a brighter lens as the two have both grown from this experience, and we know their futures now are in better hands. Great score. I can't believe I'm saying that about the Dick Figures movie, but honestly, I should probably stop talking it down at this point. It's really easy to because of the name, but in a lot of ways the movie proved itself. In a lot of ways, the web show proved itself. So how does it all end then? Figured out, the series finale to Dick Figures takes place immediately after the end of the movie, as we get a montage offering each character a conclusion. Lord Tourette stays in France and makes it big as an accordion player.
It's blatantly a fucking harp. I hate being this close to hit and render and then realizing I fucked something up. It's an accordion in the movie, okay?
Stacy goes to med school and becomes a doctor. The raccoon reunites with his entire family, Brosif goes to prison for some reason, and Mr. Dingleberry dies again. Oh yeah, it's kind of a running joke that Mr. Dingleberry dies. I swear all old web shows wanted to have a Kenny. Red and Blue move out of their apartment and go their own ways. With Blue and Pink, things are pretty much on track right away. They buy a house and they have a kid. For Red, the show actually does paint his life in a semi-realistic way.
I mean, at first they do at least. He's a better friend to Blue, sure, but he still has a lot of problems. This is another scene where Nick Keller's score really shines as Red and Stacy try to move in together like Blue and Pink did, but they aren't having nearly as much luck. They keep getting into fights and eventually Stacy leaves and Red finally has to accept he has a problem. He then goes to the fat girl's apartment and this happens.
You can go home. With me.
It's a little weird to have Red hook up with the girl he bullied relentlessly in the series. I mean, I don't know, was it relentless? He just kind of told her to go home, but it was mean. I guess I see what it's going for. He decides to be a little less shallow of a human being, and the result is him noticing the beauty that was always there, but he just refused to seek out. It's kind of a nice moment. She loses all the weight in the very next shot, completely killing the message of Red becoming a less shallow person, but hey, this is a good ending. Yeah. I'm sorry, I don't think that this is as wholesome as an ending as they thought it was. Again, I think I understand what they were going for here. Red accepts someone he didn't before, and the two of them work together to live healthier lives. There's nothing wrong with going to the gym with your partner and trying to be healthier with them, but to have her jump from this to that just comes off as more, it's like, Red's terms for her dating him. And I don't think that's what they were going for, that's just how it comes off. Like, imagine if someone bullied you throughout all of college and then showed up at your doorstep one day and said, okay, fine, I guess we can date, as long as you promise you won't be fat anymore. If you want to communicate that Red has a less shallow and gross-looking woman and he's becoming a better person, I think making this character look like a supermodel in the next shot, I mean, supermodel by the show's standards, I never thought I'd be analyzing stick figure art this heavily, I think they might have missed the point. That's what I'm saying. Well, if I'm so smart, what would have I done? Have Red apologize to this girl. Maybe give her a name. As far as we know, at the end of this episode, her name is still Fat Ugly Girl. But then have Red be alone for a while. He just got out of a nasty relationship, only recently learned how to be a decent friend to someone he's known his entire life. Maybe he needs some time to himself. Sometimes people need time to figure themselves out. Seems like it would fit with your title very well to do that. With Red constantly partying with other people, he never really got a chance to do that. He even admits at the end of the movie that he's never really had a friend before. I don't know, am I being too sensitive here? Maybe I just feel this way because I'm also a big fella who's in desperate need of Red's love. I think despite this moment not really clicking with me, most of this finale works pretty well. I like the conclusion for all the other characters, and I even like where Red is at the very end of it. I just don't know how I feel about the road we took to get there. Red and Blue's daughters meet at the same elementary school they met at, and while dropping their daughters off, they run into each other for the first time in years. Both of them have gotten their lives together, Red even mentioning that he doesn't drink anymore, and they decide to hang out with some of the spare time they have. This is accompanied by a piano cover of the movie's main theme. And that was Dick Figures, a show with a lot of ups and downs looking back at it, but there's still a decent bit that I enjoy from it. Especially with that movie, which is really like one third of the entire show's runtime. There was a spinoff called Chick Figures that follows Red and Blue's daughters when they grew up, but if it only lasted a few episodes, it never really stuck like the original show did. Red and Blue also appeared in these beef jerky commercials that they tried to claim were new episodes. For obvious reasons, I think Figured Out would have been a much better final installment from the series, but hey, what are you gonna do? Both Ed Scudder and Zach Keller have gone off to work on new things, and I think that's great. Dick Figures could probably come back to a small audience of people who remembered the old show, but I feel like it's a product of its time, and it should probably stay there. So I'm glad they didn't go any further than Chick Figures or the beef jerky commercials. So far, Pokemon Rusty is the only web show I've covered that gave the show an ending and actually stuck to it, but Dick Figures at least came close. I think the meanest way you could sum up Dick Figures is it's a show that reflects the time it came from too much and could never hold up the same way today. But I think the nicest way to sum up Dick Figures is it took an art style that even the smallest child is capable of pulling off and did something really fun and creative with it. You know what it reminds me of? It reminds me of this clip from a TV show called My Name is Earl, where someone is talking about the instrument, the jug.
You like that jug music?
Love the jug. Easiest instrument to learn, hardest to master.
Drawing a stick figure is the easiest possible thing to draw. Drawing a stick figure with a memorable design that goes off to be so popular that it can raise over $300,000 to get a feature film made about it doesn't even seem possible. When I decided to make a video on Dick Figures, I didn't think I was going to enjoy it as much as I did when I was a kid, and I really don't. But I can say despite everything, I still like Dick Figures. I'm glad it got made, and I'm glad I watched it back in middle school. And for every lame character or outdated joke, there's a decent line or creative setup that clearly inspired a lot of people. And what more could you want from a web show?